give me life. I'm expecting a victory in this fight. I am listening for what God whispers in the night. I am waiting for His whisper in the night. I'm depending on His word to give me light. I'm expecting a victory in this fight. I am listening for what God whispers in the night. In the midst of tribulation, seems that darkness has no end. When my light of faith is fragile, like a candle in the wind. All alone, though I'm surrounded by my friends and family, it's your strong voice that comforts me, your voice that says I'm near. I am for His whisper in the night. I'm depending on His word to give me light. I'm expecting a victory in this fight. I am listening for what God whispers in the night.
I'm Jeff Hall, the pastor here at Vail United Methodist Church, and I welcome you to our virtual worship service. If you would like information about the church, about this particular service, including downloading a bulletin, we invite you to go to bit.ly/Vail Church Info. Lots of information, lots of links there. If you have any prayer concerns, please enter them into the chat on Facebook, and we will lift them up in our in-person service as we are able. You can also go to our Jamboard page and note that Jamboard prayers are anonymous, so we do not know who you are. If you want us to know who you are, you'll need to add your name to that. We will have announcements about the church activities at the end of this worship service. So now, let us turn our hearts to worship Almighty God.
Good morning. I'm Tom Feeney, and I'll be your lay reader this morning. Please join with me in the call to worship. How precious is the steadfast love of God. All people may take refuge in the shadow of God's embrace. Christ is the fountain of life. In Christ we behold the light of God. Please join with me in the prayer of confession. Almighty God, source of all that is, giver of every good gift, you create all people in your image and call us to love one another as you have loved us. We confess that we have failed to honor you in the great diversity of the human family. We have desired to live in freedom while building walls between ourselves and others. We have longed to be known and accepted for who we are, while making judgments of others based on the color of their skin, or the shape of features, or the varieties of human experience. We have tried to love our neighbors individually, while yet benefiting from systems that hold those same neighbors in oppression. Forgive us, Holy God. Give us eyes to see you as you are revealed in all people. Strengthen us for the work of reconciliation rooted in love. Restore us in your image to the beloved community, united in our diversity, even as you are one with Christ and the Spirit, holy and undivided Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ has set the banquet for us this day through his death and resurrection. Accept Christ's forgiveness and come join the celebration. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, "They don't have any wine." Jesus replied, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time has not come yet." His mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby were six stone water jars used for the Jewish cleansing ritual. each able to hold about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some from them and take it to the head waiter." And they did. The head waiter tasted the water that had become wine. He didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The head waiter called the groom and said, "Everyone serves the good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine only when the guests are drinking freely. You kept the good wine until now." This was the first miraculous sign that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Last week, we reaffirmed our baptism. This week, we're going to journey with the disciples after they've been baptized and into their beginning moments of following Jesus through the book of John's account of the disciples and Jesus. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. We've all heard those horror stories. You know, the one where a new person goes to someone's home with their family and the family begins to disclose all of those wonderful, deep, dark secrets about the family and that individual. How the new person responds to these stories can be a driving force into what happens next in their relationship with each other. I've got to say that I have a lot of humorous stories that my family loves to tell on me from my childhood. What about you? Can you think of what some of those stories might be that have been told and passed down from time to time to time about you or your siblings, or maybe even your children and grandchildren? Our narrative this morning tells us a very interesting story about an encounter between Jesus and his mother, Mary. And the most fun part of this is the disciples have a backseat view of this encounter. Before we get into that, though, I'd like for us to back up a step to consider some other things that lead into this story. A short time before this account, Jesus met his cousin, John the Baptizer, at the Jordan River, and John baptized Jesus. After Jesus emerged from the water, the voice of God was heard saying, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." This is the beginning of Jesus' ministry. Now, in John's account, Jesus immediately calls the disciples to him, and his first act after they have left everything to follow Jesus is to take them back home to meet his mama. Now, when they get there, I can only imagine what the disciples felt as this was their first encounter, leaving everything behind to follow Jesus. When they get to Mary's home and they're staying there, a wedding takes place within their community. Now, weddings in Jesus' day could range anywhere from, you know, that one day period to a whole week, depending on how far away relatives were traveling from, how wealthy the family was, or even how well known they were within the region. We don't know if this was a one-day wedding or a seven-day wedding or something in between, but what we do know is that whoever was hosting this wedding, they miscalculated and they did not have enough wine. Now, this was extremely bad news for a host who clearly had not planned properly and would probably be chastised in the future for not having their plan clearly in place. Mary, who knows Jesus best, had a whispered, or maybe not so whispered, conversation with Jesus about this dilemma their host was facing. Up until this point, Jesus had not performed any miracles. at least none that were accounted for in the scriptures. But clearly Mary has some inside information about Jesus that we do not. You know, I kind of wonder what this conversation might have looked like to the disciples. I mean, think about this. They had just given up absolutely everything to follow Jesus. And where does he take them? He takes them home to meet his mom and to a common wedding feast. Nothing big or, you know, crazy about that. I'm sure that's not exactly what they had in mind when they left everything to follow Jesus. So Mary begins to tell Jesus about this problem with the wine, and Jesus replies, "Woman, this is not my time. It has not yet come." What a cryptic response, Jesus. What does that mean? My time has not yet come. But Mary takes this all in stride with his response, and she overrides Jesus completely, as mothers sometimes tend to do. She calls the servants over and she tells them to do whatever Jesus asks of them. Now, I would imagine as a disciple watching this scene play out, they would have been very interested to see what is going to happen next. They see Jesus trying to get out of doing what his mother asks. How many times can you remember trying to do that very same thing or watching your child or grandchild do this as well? Can you remember the responses that might have happened? Sometimes with a request like this comes a temper tantrum, complete with a stomping of the foot and an angry expression on the face. I admit, I tended to get a little whiny about being asked to do things that I didn't want to do, coming up with excuses. My brother would have snuggled up on my mother's lap and said those timeless words that solved every problem and got him out of every chore we ever did. "Mommy, I love you," he would say as he cuddled up on her lap, and my siblings and I would roll our eyes that yet again he got out of doing his chores. Other times, it might have been the case with Jesus, they came up with excuses. Now, we don't know, again, if there was a crowd watching, if the disciples saw this exchange with Jesus and his mother, but I like to kind of imagine what that might have been like, this intense conversation between those two, and Jesus coming up with the excuses as to why this couldn't happen. "It is not yet my time." Here are the disciples with a front row view to watch the show. I can imagine them snickering to one another as they recall similar situations that they may have had with their parents in times past. Well, with Mary taking the reins on this one and calling in the servants, Jesus seems to have no option except to respond or shame his mother by not doing what she has asked. In this, he makes a highly unusual request by asking them to bring the jars that were used for purification containers. Now, friends, these containers would have been quite large, and with them all together, it would have equaled somewhere around 150 bottles of wine. That is no small jar. That is no small feat. Instead, Jesus is showing God's abundance by bringing together what is needed in this moment, and probably more. In addition to that, Jesus does not just give any ordinary wine. No, this is Jesus, of course, and so he brings in the good stuff. And again, I can imagine the disciples standing at the side and observing this unfolding saga between Jesus and now the steward who comes to check the wine and see what they've got. And the steward approves this wine with great gusto, in fact, saying, "Wow, most hosts will give the good wine first, and then when people start to get drunk, they give the not as good wine, but no, you have saved the best for last." As the disciples are watching this, I wonder if they thought to themselves, maybe this following Jesus isn't so bad after all. I wonder what will happen next. So what are we to learn about this encounter between God and Jesus and the disciples and how we respond to our own baptismal calls? Well, first, Jesus is not afraid to let his hair down and go to a good party. God invites us to the celebration of life. Look at the joy that is in the world around us and what there is to offer. Too often we are caught up in all of the negativity and the scarcity that surrounds us in our community, and we don't see the beauty that comes when community is together to celebrate. Sometimes those celebrations may need to be small, like when we pass on one good deed to another person. I've got to tell you that my day on Wednesday did not go as planned this past week. I was prepared to come into church and to write this very sermon for you all and to hunker down and get that set. And when I went to unlock my car, my door would not open. My battery was dead. I had to wait for about an hour and a half for the tow truck to come to charge my battery back up, and I knew that I was having a secondary problem with my car that I wasn't sure if was related or not, and that my BlueLink, my remote access to start my car and to unlock the doors, was not working properly. And so while I waited for the tow truck, I called the BlueLink people at Hyundai to ask, you know, what was going on. I waited for 40 minutes before I got a human being. And when I did, the woman that I was talking to was very professional, was very, you know, I'm sorry this happened to you, let's figure out how we get through it. And as time went on and minutes passed into literally over an hour, our conversation became one of getting to know each other. So that by the time that this entire exchange was over, my car was started, and she had helped to fix the app on my phone that was having issues, it was more like I was chatting with an old friend than the professional demeanor that I had gotten at the beginning of our conversation. You see, these little moments that we are offered in life have the opportunity for us to connect with our community and the people who are there around us. How we use these opportunities can totally exchange the way that we see the world around us. I lost an entire morning of work. I could have been upset and frustrated, but instead, I made a friend and I celebrated the community coming together to solve a problem. In this case, having to figure out how to make the app work on my phone again. The second lesson that we have to learn from this is that God's gifts are extravagant. Jesus not only turns the water into wine, but it's the good stuff, friends. And it's given in abundance. This world would have us believe that there is a shortage of abundance, that we live in a world of scarcity. But when we look around, we see things differently. We know that this is not true. On Tuesday night, our youth came together for our weekly meeting, and we packed 69 bags of food for our children in the neighborhood. This food has been collected from a program that we've started here called Neighbors Feeding Neighbors. This means that at each of the stores, they are given a task of collecting an item that will go into those bags. And each person at the register is asked if they want to contribute to granola bars or juice or whatever the need is for that particular month. The food then gets collected and put into bags for our children in our community who may not necessarily have food over the course of the weekend. And this is abundance at its best. And it's only one small example of how we can come together to work for good out of the abundance rather than scarcity that is actually in our lives. We are given the gift of abundance through God. And when we are baptized into the family of God, we are claimed by God. But that's just the beginning of our journey. We are also called to change our ways and to do good for the kingdom of God. We are called to love our neighbors, especially those who are oftentimes neglected. Jesus proved this over and over. And in the coming weeks, we're going to hear more stories about how Jesus acted with justice and compassion and mercy and love and grace for the people around him. Jesus calls for justice for all people. And when we come together as community, we can celebrate in the party that is there for us. And at this party, we are invited then to be extravagant in the ways that we work for good and for change in the community so that all people have a space to feel welcome and safe and included. This party, this kingdom, is for all people. Now, lastly, friends, you might be asking, I'm baptized, but I don't know what I have to offer to this community. Well, here's the good news, my friends. God gives gifts that are unique to each one of us to share in our community that all work together for good. One of our scripture readings for this week is actually 1 Corinthians 12, 1 through 11. I invite you to look that up. And I want to tell you a little bit about some of those verses. 4 through 7 actually say this. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. God has given you unique gifts to share to build this kingdom of God. And so today I want you to consider, what gifts has God given you to bring to the party? Are you using those gifts to care for our community, for those who might feel as if they are outside of God's love? Are you actively looking to make the world a better place for all people through those gifts? We all have a part to play at this party. What is God calling you to do? Will you pray with me? Lord, we come to the party ready to celebrate, but we recognize this means using our gifts to offer abundant love, justice, and grace in the world, just as Christ taught us. May we use our gifts for your good rather than our own gain. Nothing more, nothing less, and nothing else. Amen.
As we turn to God in prayer, I will offer a prayer and I will close it with, Lord, in your mercy, and invite you to join in by saying, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, in every gathering of Christian believers, you bring together a people of gifts, strengths, and needs to manifest the universal body of Christ. And so we pray for your church throughout the world, that in every congregation may live together as sisters and brothers in harmony, showing forth the light of Christ to the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In every age, you raise up servant leaders for your people. And so we pray for all who teach and lead. We pray for our bishop, Sharma Lewis, for our district superintendent, Sarah Calvert, and for all who serve in your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the sake of the common good of all people, you have created human societies to be places of refuge and human flourishing. We pray for the leaders of governments throughout the world. But we especially pray for our leaders, for President Biden, Governor Northam, incoming Governor Youngkin, and others who are in public service. May they receive wisdom to exercise government with true justice, grounded in mercy. May they seek your kingdom and not their own. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus, you performed the first of your signs of glory at a wedding in Cana. We pray for all who are joined as family, for husbands and wives, for all who make covenant to live together for mutual support and love, for parents and children, for the aged and the young. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the many in our community who are dealing with illness, with strife, for those who do not have enough to eat or a warm place to live, for a place, safe place for their lives. We lift up those in our community who are dealing with cancer, especially Jane, Iris, Kathy, Natasha, Eleanor, Lily, Mark, John, Mark, and Mary. Lord, bring them comfort, bring wisdom to the doctors and all those who bring your loving care to them. Bring your presence to those who are worried and afraid. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you are the giver of all good things, and so we ask that you would receive our prayers that we offer for ourselves and for our world. In all things, grant us the courage to exercise your gifts for the good of our world, through Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Yeah.
Thank you for your continued support of the ministries here at Vail, for all the wonderful things that we are able to do because of that. If you go to our website, you can go to PushPay and give electronically. You can set up a one-time or a recurring contribution for that if you wish. And now let us receive these offerings. Lord, at the wedding feast of Cana, you gladdened the guests with divine generosity. You filled to the brim and flowed over. And so we offer our gifts with grateful hearts. Bless these gifts. Bless our lives to your service that they may reveal your glory, nurture faith, and manifest the common good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we go, just a couple of things. We have multiple ongoing studies throughout the week. Our Sunday evening group is on hiatus until Lent, but we will pick that up again. Our Wednesday morning study on grief is available. We meet virtually as well as in person, and you can contact the church if you would like that information and link. Our Saturday morning women's virtual group is reading together. We invite you to join us for that. And as always, thank you for worshiping with us this morning. And now may the Spirit's love, flowing like water across the face of the earth, fill you with every gift for the good of the world. And may the blessing of God, eternal source, fountain of life, and giver of gifts, be with you always. Amen.